I would like to invite Ipsita and Sunitha Krishnan to start the conversation.
Very good afternoon to all those who are present here. I would like to express my sincere gratitude to the organizers of HLF who have given this opportunity to converse once again with my friend, with an inspiration called Sunitha Krishnan. It's now very cliched to say that Sunitha Krishnan needs no inspiration, but as someone who is moderating this session, I think it is also my responsibility and duty just to say a few words. Sunitha Krishnan, a Padma Shri award winner, has been associated with Prajwala, an organization she has founded. The organization is now well over 20 years and works in the area of human trafficking. Sunitha has been a firebrand activist, but her very important contribution has been to take a step forward to document what happens in the process of trafficking. I think it's very extremely important, because activists often don't write about their experiences, which she had, in order to ensure that the issue of human trafficking, which is actually a very major crime. In fact, it is the third most prevalent crime after arms and drugs in this world. You know, she has, through her several short films, actually ensured that this occupies a degree of mind space in the minds of the people. So, her organization Prajwala has been associated with, you know, rescue, rehabilitation and reintegration of survivors of human trafficking. She is also partnering with several NGOs to create a layer of protection and a whole set of rehabilitative services for the survivors of trafficking. So thank you very much, Sunitha, for joining us here. So as I said, that, you know, it is a very important issue that we face today, but unfortunately I think not much is known about human trafficking. You know, it's very easy to talk about the problems of malnutrition, for example, it's quite well known, but what exactly is human trafficking and how does it affect the survivors? What is the scale and magnitude of the problem? If you could throw some light on the issue.
Thank you, Ipsita. Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be in HLF today. Thank you, Ajay. Thank you, Vijay, for having me here. Well, human trafficking is one of the most, I think, the worst form of human rights violation. And it's as old as humankind, but today, the face of human trafficking is as an organized crime, as a $858 billion industry, next to drugs and arms. But unfortunately, people understand human trafficking as sex trafficking. People think that human beings are only sold for prostitution. That is not so. Human beings are sold for various purposes of exploitation. So human trafficking is, very simply, if you have to define human trafficking, it's about the sale of human beings for the purposes of exploitation. Now, if you ask me, what is the age of a human being who's getting sold? The youngest human being that is sold is 1 day old. As soon as an infant is born, India, unfortunately, has perhaps all forms of exploitation, where young babies as young as 1 day and 2 day have been sold in the name of adoption, and then thereafter sold for organ trade and organ harvesting and things like that. So human beings as young as 1 day are sold for adoption, children are sold for beggary, children are sold for camel jockeying, children are sold for domestic work, sweatshops. You also have a huge number of children being sold for circus. I'm giving you the example of children to tell you how from which place it starts. But I think among all these forms of exploitation, trafficking for the purposes of prostitution or commercial sexual exploitation could be the worst form, because one, you know, if you look at India per se, the global slavery index says that we have 18 million slaves in India. And of the 18 million slaves in India, 80% are the ones in sex slavery, which is brothels, all places of sexual
slavery. 80%?
Yes. And here again, if you see, the youngest child that I have rescued in my last 25 years is around 3.5 years old from prostitution. So even in that space, that is the profile of human beings with scope. Now, unlike other forms of exploitation in human trafficking, where you're able to identify the victim very, very clearly, like in, say, labor trafficking, or in domestic work, or in circus, or in adoption also, you're able to identify the victim because the victim is able to identify and say, yes, I'm a victim. But in the domain of trafficking for the purposes of prostitution, a point of no return is there, where the victim, after a little while, stops becoming a victim and starts normalizing the experience of being exploited. So much so that when you actually go for a rescue, you might see an 8-year-old child in a brothel, and the 8-year-old child is actually resisting your rescue. Saying that is the damage that trafficking for prostitution has. And I don't think it's very difficult to understand the damage when you realize sex trafficking and sex trade is about getting raped 40 times, 50 times a day by 40 different kinds of men with 40 different tastes of sex. To just survive in that world of slavery and that kind of hell, the person has to start drinking alcohol, take drugs, become a total addict, substance abuser. So, progressively, your body, your mind, your soul, everything is systematically demolished, And therefore, the human person that you get when you rescue from sex trafficking is a human person who believes this exploitation is what I want to be. I don't want your hell. Maybe, this hell is better than your so-called protective home or safe home. So that is something, I think it's kind of the irreversible damage that sex trafficking does to human beings. And that is what makes it very different from other forms of exploitation.
That explains, that it is really a very dehumanizing experience for those who, survive this kind of exploitation. But Sunitha, tell me, what motivated you to, engage with this?
I was kind of oriented, or I can't say oriented. I think it was in my DNA. I was born with the genes that I wanted to do something for somebody. I don't know whether that was a survival mechanism for my own self. But my mother tells me that I was, as a 3-year-old child, I was one person who would collect children from all over my neighborhood to teach them. By 8 years, I was more or less a hardcore social worker at that time. By 12, I was running my own school for children in a slum. So by this time, I think I was a mini celebrity. Every parent wanted to have a child like Sunitha Krishnan. So I was the big problem for my classmates, my friends. Nobody liked me. Everybody kind of hated me, because this is, every parent would say, okay, this is how your, this is the way your daughter should be, because I was all the nice, the best achiever, the top ranker. I think life changed for me when, at the age of 15, when I was gang raped. Suddenly, my entire cycle suddenly changed. From being at the top of the world, I was brought down. Now I was the worst human being in the world. I was the dirtiest human being. I was a characterless person. I still remember in school, I think parents had told their children that they should not interact with me, because I was a moralless person. And so I used to have a, a situation where people used to actually move out of my table and think my parents couldn't go to social functions. So all that I was supposed to be great at till the age of 15 became just the opposite after that. I think that isolation, that stigmatization, that marginalization, and that sense of outrage to be victimized for a crime that you did not commit. Some 8 people have violated you, and here you are being subjected. Why did she go there? Why did she do this? My parents were accused of giving me too much of freedom and, you know, keeping me on the head and
typical
things like
that. Typical signs of victim blaming.
I think that triggered this whole journey, because I think that's a time that I realized that there's a whole world of people out there who are thrown out of the society for no fault of their own. And the world kind of enjoys and relishes, and there's so much of voyeuristic, I don't know what, pleasure for everybody to discuss how horrible that girl is. You know, see, this is what happens if too much of freedom is given.
And how she asked for it.
How she asked for it and things like that. So I think that anger, and for me that was a strange part, because yes, I'm not saying I didn't feel the pain of rape. I did not go through all the nightmares that any victim would go through. But for some reason, I could not relate myself as a victim. I chose to be a survivor. I'm still a survivor of that experience. And but that choice of being a survivor is also filled with a lot of anger. Anger and outrage on this absolute unfairness of how a human being is treated. And that set me off in this journey where I said, ki every breath of my life from now on till my dying day, I will commit myself to human beings who are victimized unfairly in a sexual offense. And now I'm here.
Okay. Thanks for sharing your experience, Sunitha. I would also like to know that from a victim of a gang rape to a survivor to a Padma Shri recipient, it has been a long journey, and I'm sure it has not been easy. How do you think Prajwala as an organization came into being, and how has it evolved over the last 20 years? What has been the trajectory of this journey?
I think at different levels, many things have not changed. You know, the intensity of what used to happen 25 years back, or the kind of challenges you faced 25 years back, was at some level. So-called label you have called as Padma Shri, I really don't know whether that is a good thing or bad thing, because 1 year after Padma Shri today, meaning exactly last year, 1 year now that I have received the Padma Shri, and I find it actually a burdensome thing. I find people judge me more now. So 25 years back I was judged. 25 years later I'm being judged. Now people pick up on me. You know, you're a Padma Shri, you should not talk like this. Or how did you get your Padma Shri? This way or that way. The level and intensity of being judged, being isolated, that has not changed. But what has changed is the level of possibilities. From a point where I thought, what should I be doing and how should I respond? Today, I have answers. Today, 25 years later, I can say, yes, this is one way out of this. Prajwala is, to me, a laboratory where I experimented on possibilities. When I came to Hyderabad after a very eventful time in Bangalore, where I went to the jail protesting the missile pageant, I think that was my second transformative moment in my life, because you know, when people psychologically throw out people, that is one kind of isolation you go through. But when people physically throw you out of your, you know, their mind space, that's another kind of rejection, you know. That's what I went through in the jail. My entire family, my entire lot who knew me decided that they no more owned Sunitha in terms of... When I was gang raped, nobody did that to me. They actually tolerated me in their houses. But the jail was the last thing in their life. So I had a situation in the jail where nobody actually came to see me in the jail. Everybody was so ashamed and so horrified that, you know, she went to the jail. In fact, one of my uncles said that, you know, before 1947, people actually went to jail for freedom fights and all. But after 1947, only criminals have gone. So he kind of declared, yeah, here's one more family criminal and all that stuff. But the worst was, I had taken part in a protest and I was in this same costume, khadi kurta jeans pant, and end of the protest, all kinds of paint and everything was there all over. And that's how we were arrested and taken to the jail. There was nobody to get me a pair of clothes to change. And under trials, don't get a, you know, we don't get change of clothes in the thing. It's only a convict which gets a uniform. So for more than a month or so, I was there with just one pair of, one jeans and one kurta. From 10 o'clock to 3 o'clock is the mulaqat time. That's when all the criminals get people to visit them. So this is this big women's jail, and there were 400 and odd women prisoners there under trials and convicts. And there's this big gate around there. And then a gong will hit and this entire place will become pin drop silence. Everybody is like listening to the door, because that's when number or a name is announced for the visitor. So everybody is every day waiting for somebody to come and visit. For more than 30 days, I would wait for my name to be called. Somebody to come and see me. Somebody to give me a change of clothes. I think that physical isolation was I think, the biggest lesson for me to start Prajwala. Because my children, my girls, my women whom I rescued today are those whom all of you all have physically isolated. In your mind, in your thinking, your denial, your silence is as if they don't exist at all. You know, that rejection is something that is, it's horrifying, you know, because you want people, you want to belong. So Prajwala is a journey of creating that space for people who have been completely rejected back by the society. Giving them a sense of hope in themselves. Because I think that's what I learned from my journey. From the age of 15, from the time I was thrown out of the society, I think one of my best supporter, my greatest strength was my own self. The fact that I was able to harness the power inside me under the layers of pain that I was subjected to became my greatest partner and my companion in the journey. So I never felt alone. Yes, there were lonely moments, you know. I don't know whether you can understand that. There was loneliness, yes, but there was no loneliness. So Prajwala began for little children of women in prostitution to create that a little space for them to gain those skills, dignity. We started with around 5 children for their education and their mainstreaming thing. Today we have more than 21 learning centers with more than 8,000 children who have been reintegrated back to society. The journey started with a small learning center for children, then over the period of time evolved into a program to rescue women and children from prostitution. You know, we are not a project-based organization. We are not a, you know, we are not the kind of organization which started because we had some project and we started, it started with, because there was a Mehboob Ki Mehndi which was getting evicted here, and by default from Bangalore, I had landed here. So, and it kind of all the dots were connected. So when I started the learning center, it was just a learning center and I was the first teacher. And then when the mother started talking about that 10-year-old child whom she saw on Tangban Road or in the Indra Park or somewhere else, I don't know how many of you know that close to 20,000 to 25,000 children in Hyderabad city alone are sex trafficked every year, you know, and children as young as 4 and 5 years right here in Hyderabad. In practically, there's no particular area. You can't say it's not happening in Old City or in New City, but every part of the city. So when the women started telling, you know, ma'am, madam, hum logon ne aaj 8 saal ki bachchi ko dekha ya 10 saal ki bachchi ko dekha, that's when the rescue began. Also, Prajwala was not just a possible, you know, an experiment of possibility, but also an experiment in partnership. Because I came from a background which did not believe in the outside world. I came from a background which felt that I have to only depend on myself, so I have to do, I have to, you know, provide them whatever it is. But then, by default, one started learning. I remember when I started the rescue, I didn't believe that police were. I used to think, or rather not only think, I have actually believed. Because, you know, just before that, I was in the jail, I had seen a different side of the police's face. You know, when you're on under trial, the police is dealing you in a certain way. So you develop that cynicism against them. So I felt that they're part active partners in the crime. So how can they even help me in a rescue? So the beginning of my rescues were all James Bond activities, you know. One would go and rush into a brothel and felt very top of the world, getting beaten up, because that was the sign that you have done a great job. You know, so it was a great idea to be bleeding from your nose and from your ears and coming out victorious with one child a day. I think it went for some time like that, and then a colleague of mine was murdered. That was kind of a wake-up call for me in terms of, from a very strategic point of view, where I realized that this way of doing things may not be a good idea. I realized that if people start dying, nobody will join me. Maybe that was the thought behind actually working and engaging with stakeholders. And that's how I started working with the police. And till date, close to 22,000 policemen have been trained through our organization. I've personally trained 22,000 policemen. So when we started working with the police, we realized that not all of them are bad, you know. There is this number of good officers. Yes, there are bad ones also this side, but there's a huge number who are these fence sitters, you know, neither here nor there. So one entered through the good ones, converted the, you know, fence sitters to the thing. So today I'm so proud to say that I'm blessed to meet one of the greatest officers, from a court constable, you know, to an IPS officer. You've seen the best of the lot who have stood by the cause. So suddenly the way your rescues started changed. One point of time you would rescue one child, come out, be in the hospital for 1 month, and then maybe do the next rescue. So one child, 1 month. Now, you know, there have been times when I have rescued 400 children or 400 girls at one shot. So that's the power of partnership. You know, and then you realize very clearly when you rescue them, bring them out, what do you do with them? The beginning, I remember, because my co-founder, Brother Joe's, who died in 2005, he's a Catholic missionary. So he had a lot of all these nuns and all of them in his network. So the first rescues, I still remember, you know, where do we take them? That was a billion dollar question that we had in our mind. So we put them in some homes and boarding schools and things like that. Then slowly you realize that you're being more unfair to the child. This child asks me, you know, why did you bring me from one hell and put me into another hell? The simple thing was that the people who were running these places did not understand how to deal with these children. Here is a child who is highly sexualized. She has had 20 times sex a day. She wakes up in the morning drinking gudumba. That is the first drop of water that goes into the mouth. Throughout the day, you are drinking gudumba packets, or you are taking hashish, ganja, or alcohol, beer. Every 1 hour, you have a customer. This is an 8-year-old child. This is what you're used to. So when you come to a normal setting, your language is different, your body language is different, you speak different, you think different, you just become like a fish out of water in the space. The people who are running the show don't know how to deal with it. Even not just a child who has been exploited, but even a child who has seen that exploitation. I still remember this 3-year-old child that I had pulled out of the space. Extremely brilliant child, right here in Secunderabad station. I used to go there because on the platform, outside the bus stop, a lot of prostitution happens, and there's a little lot of children and young adults also in prostitution. So this child, just 3 years old, as soon as I would enter, she would say, "Auntie, you know, wo bus aa gaya, wahan jana hai aapko, ye jana hai." Extremely sharp, you know, such sharp memory. So I thought this one was like really, you know, somebody who needs all our help. And I pulled her out, practically kidnapped her from that situation and put her in a, you know, took her to a boarding school, a very prominent school here in Hyderabad. And she went through the merit, you know, she went through the interview, passed the interview and joined the school in the boarding school. And apparently some visitors had come to the school that day or something like that, to the hostel that day. And they had made the children sit, and the children were said, "You have to sing a poem or something like that. And whoever will sing the poem will get the chocolate or something." My child did not get the chocolate. Okay. So she goes up to the visitor and says, "Uncle, main apna frock upar karun, aap mujhe chocolate doge." Now this is what the child has seen every day. She has seen this mother who lifts up a sari every day and in return gets some money. So she has associated that every time you lift your frock or your sari, you will get money. Now the sister were shocked. She says, "Please take her immediately out. You know, this is something we cannot take this. She's, corrupting other children. She's a bad influence on other children. The kind of language she uses. Oh, see, this is what she has done. Now we don't know how to face the visitors." So that's when I realized that it's not right of us to put them in places where people are not trained or equipped or oriented to do this kind of work. And that forced us to start our shelter home today. Today, we have rescued 17,000 women and children out of prostitution. And over the last 20 years, we started in small sheds when we started our homes. But today we run one of the biggest shelter homes, perhaps in the world, but definitely in the country, which has a capacity to take care of nearly 1,200 victims at any given point of time. For children, for adults, we run 3 shelter homes. So we moved from just being like a learning center to get into big rescues, now to have very holistic rehabilitation program. At some point of the journey, we felt that just doing activities on the ground will not help the cause in a bigger way, and therefore one has to also become a powerful voice in the advocacy. And what we were learning from the ground became the the learning thoughts that we carried to the governments, both at the central level and the state level. I think I'm extremely proud to say that the two Telugu states are one of the first states in the country who at least had the guts not to deny the problem and say, "Yes, we acknowledge there is a problem that Andhra and Telangana is the second largest supplier of women and children for prostitution, and therefore we have to do something." And way back in 2003 itself, because of our recommendation, policy was formed in Andhra Pradesh and now Telangana. Similarly, we started filing public interest litigations in the Supreme Court. So today we are at the brink where we are getting a comprehensive legislation in the country on trafficking, thanks to the public interest litigation that we filed in the Supreme Court. So yeah, just as a very small initiative from then to yes, today we have become, I would say, not a powerful voice, but a very significant voice whose ensuring that the voices of the survivors is brought on the table and becomes a conversation point. And I think today's exercises is also an exercise to ensure the voices of the unheard is brought to you. So yes, today we are an acknowledged voice. That is the journey.
Thank you
very
much.
But whether we have become a successful voice, I don't think so. Long way to go.
I'll be a devil's advocate for this question, and I would like to ask you, did you weigh two options, one of what you are doing against maybe strengthening the existing homes? We know we have several shelter homes. We know that they club all kinds of survivors together. But still, I would like to ask you, for the benefit of all of us here, why did you choose to, quote unquote, have a parallel setup rather than strengthen what was already there?
I think, as I said, Ipsita, in the beginning itself, that I call Prajwala as a laboratory of experiments in providing counter-trafficking solutions. So for me, it was very important that I set up a model first. You know, the kind of shelter homes that I imagine and envision, because somebody who has, see, when you rescue a person, for example, you rescue, from the point of rescue, it's a legal thing. You can't just pull out some two people and bring them and illegally keep them in your place and say, okay, I've rescued enough thing. From the point that you enter a rescue, it's a very legal process because you're carrying the police with you. That means there is an FIR, there is a complaint. And therefore, the people whom you have rescued are not just victims, they're also victim witnesses. They are produced in the court. There is a court order which says, okay, we are giving this children to Prajwala for safe custody and further rehabilitation. So the whole safe custody, and therefore the kind of home that you're running, you like it, you don't like it, is a custodial care institution. You know, it's not like an open space where anybody and everybody can come. For those of you who know me, and some of you, I don't know, I see some familiar faces who have requested, can we come and visit your shelter? And the first answer is no. We are not a tourism space. We are not an orphanage or something like that where people can come and see, oh, these are trafficked victims, you want to do something for it. We can't allow volunteers, we can't allow interns, because there's so much of these, the people that I'm holding in my hand are all witnesses in big cases. You know, they'll be testifying against a whole lot of organized criminals, and therefore their custody, their security and their safety is the most crucial thing. And therefore, how do we ensure dignity is restored to these victims and they move on to become survivors in a custodial care space? So that model, I had to first do it myself. It's very easy to preach, you know. It's very easy to become an armchair critique about institution and institutional framework. I didn't want to become trapped in that kind of a, hypocritical space. I wanted to see how it is done correctly and then advocate for it. So today I am running three shelters. One is an emergency shelter meant for new victims. One is a children's shelter and one is an adult shelter. And you must understand that these are three different kind of categories of people. A little one, 5 or 6 years old, is going to be with me till the age of 18. This child could be HIV positive, but this child also has this huge resilience that I can bank on. And therefore her journey of becoming a survivor is a different journey than an adult woman who has been, say, 6 years into sex slavery. In any average brothel in India, whether it is GB Road or Shonagachi or Kamatipura, average, a girl has to service around 50 to 60 customers a day, average. You know, you don't sleep with that many number of people. Your brothel keeper, your pimp, and the entire network of people who live on that earnings will not get the money. So from 50 rupees to 500 rupees is a range that people pay to have sex with a body. So that, the more the number, that is how the revenue is increased. So the pressure is on that person to, you know, continuously service as many as possible. So by 2 in the afternoon, if the work timing starts, tomorrow morning at 5, the work timing will end. So that kind of person who is done that has a different feeling. Whereas a child is kind of the big demand. Every man wants to have sex with a little child in these places. They would go for any number, meaning any amount, to have sex with a 5-year-old child or 6-year-old child. And therefore, this child will not be given, say, to 50, 60 people. This child has to be protected because, you know, I don't know whether you understand what 50, 60 people means. 50, 60 people means 50, 60 different libidos. So there are men who will come and say, I want to cut you. You know, they take a blade and think, I need that kind of sex. Or men will say, I want to hit you with a whip. Or I want to burn you with cigarette. So that is a form of sex. So a small little one, if you damage that much, you may not get the buyer. So it's very ironic to say this, but you know, to deal with a child victim, you need a different kind of skill. But to deal with an adult victim who is completely desensitized, you need another kind of skill. So you can't club these people together. You can't put adults and children together. So, and then for an adult victim, you can't introduce, say, okay, now I want to teach you ABCD 1, 2, 3. It doesn't work. Whereas for a child, you can't say, okay, come on, start working today. So with a child, you're experimenting on education, alternate education, open school, everything that would put them on, because it's a long road ahead. With an adult, you're experimenting on livelihood, life skills, working with different corporates, ensuring that they get something sustainable. You realize the hard way that tailoring embroidery doesn't work with them. You realize the hard way that weaving and candle making doesn't work for them. So then you have to start, because you know, and my background is not, I'm not a technical person. So one has to constantly apply your mind to see what will work for them. And luckily, Brother Joe, you know, started, and of course,